We're doing a series on cardiogenetics. This one's on familial hypercholesterolemia. Now, there's been a debate for a long time. If you ask over 90% of doctors, they'll say the majority of cardiovascular risk has to do with cholesterol. There's the other side of that argument. There are others that say, no, actually, cholesterol's not a problem at all. And in fact, you listen to some people like Nir Ali, and they say you want to have high LDL values. Now, what's the story here? I'll tell you, I don't fall in either of those camps completely. We'll talk about a little bit more where I fall and what and some of the reasoning behind that. We've done several videos on FH. We've talked about a couple of stories. Sue, who had challenges and then has gotten beyond them. Jake, the same thing. We've talked about signs and symptoms and why it might be a problem waiting for a sign or symptom. We've talked about drugs and the lifestyle issues associated with managing this problem. Now, wait a minute. Is this a mistake? I'm starting off on a deck on FH, familial hypercholesterolemia, and then I go into 9P21. Those of you who remember it, may remember that 9P21, the 9th chromosome, the P21 area, that's the heart attack gene. Some of you may have read Brad and Amy Dineen's book, Beat the Heart Attack Gene. What's that doing in an FH deck? I'll get to that a little bit later. But let's go back and talk about this theme that you continue to hear from me. Sue is a great example of this theme, that it's not just FH alone. It's FH plus something else. As a young woman in her mid-30s, she went hiking, came home, had some chest pain, went to her doctor, and the doctor said, you know what, I think this is just the nervousness that I often see in young women, not really significant chest pain. Didn't draw blood, didn't really look any deeper, sent her home. She went back within a day or two and said, I think you need to draw some blood, check on some things, this is more than just nervousness. Sure enough, she had FH, and she ended up having a 5-vessel bypass over the next couple of days. She was fine then, but let me go back and say, well, was that her FH? It was more than just her FH. Obviously, her doctor began to listen to her more when she said, this is not just nervousness, but she also began to listen to her doctor when he said, Sue, you gotta quit smoking. So it was FH and smoking. She did fine from that point up until about her mid-50s when she needed to have another bypass. And here was the problem at that point. She'd gotten nervous about this FH problem. She, like many of us do, dealt with her nervousness by eating too much. She had gotten obese. She needed to lose a lot of weight. And she did. She lost 125 pounds. Her brother actually calls her half a Sue now because she lost about half her body weight. At this point, she's over 70 years old. She's not taking statins, that's her choice, but she's healthy right now. And the point is this, FH doesn't always cause events. Often it doesn't cause events at all on its own, but it's FH plus smoking, plus obesity, plus insulin resistance, and plus some other things that we'll talk about a little bit later. Now, I mentioned we covered Jake's story. We've got a whole series on Jake's story. He's a 40-year-old, known lean mass hyper-responder. Now, that term was coined by a fellow named Dave Feldman, and I agree with a lot of what Dave Feldman describes in regards to lean mass hyper-responders. There's a couple of places that we don't 100% agree. For example, one of them is a statement by Feldman that lean mass hyperresponders are not FH patients. I would say sometimes that's correct, but if you begin to realize how big the universe is of people with different versions of FH, you begin to go back and really doubt that statement. We'll talk about just how big that universe is in just a minute. How many people and how many variations you can have of FH. Back to Jake's story, he clearly had a family history. He managed his to a large extent with lifestyle. There was a time when he needed medications, but again, he's a great example of the importance of lifestyle in managing this problem. Now, I can't talk about FH and not talk about this issue. You look it up in a book and they'll say, well, what are the signs of familial hypercholesterolemia? They'll mention xanthelasma. You don't need to know that term. You just look at these and you see these little white specks in the Achilles heel, in the eyelid, in the eye itself, in knuckles. Those are actually deposits of cholesterol. Don't wait for those. That's the problem. Waiting to find people with signs of disease is as bad as waiting for people to show signs of insulin resistance, prediabetes, atrial fib, cardiovascular inflammation. Don't wait for signs. Don't wait for symptoms. You don't have those. Test, don't guess. Go ahead and have a degree of suspicion and start checking people out, getting yourself checked out. So, a couple of words about the genetics of familial hypercholesterolemia. Just real quick, this is from the FH Foundation website, and they give you a good description with an image showing what heterozygous versus homozygous is. That's helpful until you get to the next slide, and we'll talk about that next slide when we get there. Heterozygous means you've inherited one from your mom or dad, but not from the other. And homozygous means you've inherited one from both of them. I'll give you a brief comment about a couple of slides down. There are over 1,200 different variations. So what if you inherit one category from your mom and another category from your dad, or three or four from each? That's when it becomes complicated and a much bigger deal. And now you're beginning to get back to what I was talking about when I said the universe of FH is far bigger than most doctors realize. The FH Foundation site does great graphics. They've got a great graphic here showing that 90% of people with this problem are undiagnosed. And again, as you go back to my example on just how many types of variations there are, the failure of the medical community to have an index of suspicion to screen for this, then you begin to realize that 90% is probably a very low estimate of the number of people that have this problem, but just are not being tested. Can't have any discussion about FH with talking just briefly about medications. People always ask about it. Yes, the vast majority of my folks focus on lifestyle, but beyond lifestyle, are there medications? Yes, the vast majority of my patients do well on statins. There are other medications, ezetimibe. These are medications which decrease absorption. There's an antisense drug. It's called mipomersen. It's been around for a while. It's dangerous. You don't go on mipomersen unless you go on to a special risk management program. One of the reasons mipomersen is interesting is that it's an antisense drug. Those of you with Lp(a), another genetic problem, may remember that there's a lot of interest right now and great reviews coming up with antisense drugs for Lp(a). Now, don't make the connection that if there are liver problems, significant danger with mipomersen for FH, then maybe the other antisense drugs have that same problem. I don't think you should be saying that or worrying about that at that point. We'll cover those drugs when we get to Lp(a). The big drug class, it's a new class, the PCSK9 inhibitors, are the ones that were developed specifically for FH, and they've done a great job. But as I've said, you're beginning to hear this theme, most FH patients really don't need these level of drugs to do very well. To go back, I talked for a couple of times about the large universe of FH. There are over 1,200 SNPs. What's a SNP? Wait a minute. Don't need to know that. It's single nucleotide polymorphism, but you don't need to know that term. Most people think of this as a mutation. Here's why you don't hear the term mutation used. A mutation only happens once. Once it becomes inherited, it's a SNP, a single nucleotide polymorphism. I just tend to use the term genetic variation. So here's the thing. There are at least 1,200, closer to 2,000 variations that can result in hypercholesterolemia. There are even five classes of them. Some of them involve the protein itself. Remember, ApoA forms the HDL particle and ApoB forms the LDL particle. So that's one of the areas to look at. Another area is the LDL receptor itself. You see, the liver waits for LDL to pass through it has receptors. When an LDL particle touches a liver receptor, it pulls that LDL into the cell and burns it up. It metabolizes it. So there are problems with that receptor. There are also problems with the receptor cycling for LDL. So I'm getting a little bit geeky, a little bit too deep, a little bit too detailed, but now maybe you can start to see why there are so many different variations of genetic problems which can result in familial hypercholesterolemia. One last comment that I make before I finish up is index of suspicion. If you've ever had an LDL 180 or above, you've got a pretty good chance of having one of these genetic variations. Get it checked out. Now, the last thing gets back to the very beginning. Again, am I talking about the heart attack gene here or FH? I'm talking about FH. And here's the thing, here's what you see on this slide. It's one thing to have the heart attack gene, it's a very different thing to have FH, but it appears to be a multiplied risk if you have both. So it gets back to that general theme that we've been discussing over and over again. It's not just one genetic risk factor, it's the interplay between multiple risk factors, some genetic, some lifestyle. Thank you very much for your interest. Continue to get great feedback regarding the webinars, and here's why. You know, on the internet, when you hear a webinar, you expect for somebody to try to sell you something. We're not doing that. We're trying to tell you something. People are coming in with their labs from Quest, inflammation panel, OGTT, insulin survey response, and then they're finding out, do I have inflammation? Do I have insulin resistance? And where does that fit in terms of other folks? We're getting ready to start one for CIMT as well. So again, people are really excited about finding out their own status. Looking forward to seeing you there. Thanks.